Hello there, and thanks for joining us right here on The Nation. It is a show today that will focus on structural wonders, architectural amazement, and we're looking at some of the best buildings we have right here in Malaysia. And for today's discussion, my very special guest is an architect who's Mr. Azim A. Aziz, CEO of ATSA Architects, an award-winning architectural firm right here in Malaysia. So welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for joining us. It's ultimately our pleasure. We would like to, of course, today highlight on some of the building structures we have in Malaysia, where we are in this field, how far we've come from, and benchmarking with the international, the international landscape, as well as looking at green buildings, which is very much the hot topic now. Before we get messy with that, perhaps you could just give us a brief background about yourself.
I'm born in KL. Mm-hmm. Went to school in the UK, in Malaysia, mm-hmm. in UK, and also in the US. Mm-hmm. Graduated as a graduate architect in the US in a school in the Louisiana State University, and been back here for almost 30 years. Mm-hmm. And I've already started my practice for about now 23 years, and my office is located in Tamantun, and we are about 60 to 70 people, mm-hmm. and we do work throughout Malaysia and some overseas.
Well, you're definitely the man for the job, because we spoke a little bit before the show, and you have sort of put together this book, which is a collection of selected mosques from around the Islamic world, and it truly features some of the most wonderful architecture of mosques. And we know that in many of the mosques, they are just amazing design and structural building, and it's just wonderful. So definitely, truly, your passion. Where did that come from? When did you decide, I wanted to be an architect?
Oh, actually, I wanted to become an architect when I was 7 years old. Actually, it was a push from my father, my mm-hmm. late father. Mm-hmm. And at that time, he was friends with Datuk Bahruddin. Datuk Bahruddin, as you know, is the architect of the Masjid Negara. So I liked, when I was small, I liked drawing. So he says, okay, never mind, you become an architect.
Yeah.
So, and 15 years later, I was working with Datuk Bahruddin as an intern. So it started from there. Mm-hmm. At that time, he was building the Sha'ala Mosque. Mm-hmm. Mosque architecture, what I am fascinated by Datuk's approach is that he doesn't copy entirely from the traditional architecture, mm-hmm. or the history or copy from blindly, mm-hmm. but he innovate the mosque. And so what he does is an interpretation, a Malaysian interpretation, or his interpretation in a modern context and environment. Mm-hmm. So that actually, to me, was something that is amazing.
Yeah.
As a young architect, or someone who wanted to become an architect,
aspired to be a good architect, which you have already done so today.
Yes.
And what's also interesting is that although it may seem quite straightforward in terms of it's very scientific to a large extent, but it's also using your imagination,
yes.
and putting in your own, you know, your own spirit into it.
Mm-hmm. When you talk about architecture, it's art and science, mm-hmm. of a building, and to some it's a public art. Architecture, it can be pleasing, and it can be some architect will call it as visual pollution. So what you're trying to do always as an architect is like an artist. You can create something,
mm-hmm.
and although it seems easy as that, but it has a lot of stakeholders,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes it's how you sell the architecture, your belief in how the building should be,
mm-hmm.
And for the stakeholders to believe in you that, mm-hmm. you can do an architecture of this sort,
mm-hmm.
and will help improve our built environment.
Mm-hmm. What makes a building structure good? What makes it good, or the average good or great?
Actually, when you design, design for the people. You have to have the people in mind,
mm-hmm.
and whether it's just a box, it has to work. It has to work as a building. It has to work. It's little things and how it's function, like an office building has a function of office building, like a house has a function as a house to the particular person, and even a mosque you have to design to the whole general Muslim population. Mm-hmm. So you have to first look at the needs mm-hmm. of the people. And sometimes needs is based on culture, mm-hmm. is based on my behavior. So architecture does teach you to react to or to design towards behavior, people's behavior or needs or culture. Mm-hmm. And secondly, it has to be comfortable. Mm-hmm. When you are in the building, the air condition works, you have sunlight in, you have easy access. And comfortable, and from the outside, it has to be able to fit in the built environment into the skyline.
Can't stick out like a sore thumb.
yes, but you can't stick. But there are many that are building that are competing with each other.
Yeah.
In terms of, it's like a beauty parade. Mm-hmm. Where you arrange all the buildings. Everyone wants a building to be iconic. So sometimes you have to prepare for that. That's as an architect.
Well, I think from what you're saying, every building is unique in its own way.
Yeah.
It has its unique set of external and internal, issues, and it's its own work of art. But looking at how as a nation we have progressed in this particular field, what do you think about the current state of our architecture practice in Malaysia?
Before that, Malaysia as it is now as a country, it never existed 57 years ago. Or 58 years ago, it was only became a nation.
Yeah.
So we were very fortunate that we don't have that over external baggage to carry. So we had to create anew.
Create our own.
Yeah. So that's one thing that is was good, and our starting point was low population.
Mm-hmm.
So when we obtained our independence, Malaya at that time, mm-hmm. in 1957, our population is only about 7 million.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as you know, our population last year has grown up to 30 million.
Yes.
And that's very fast. But having that room to grow has allowed the building people to build following the time. Mm-hmm. So you can see buildings evolve over time. The architecture, in terms of architectural, has improved very much from earlier. It is better, it didn't do too well, and now it's getting better.
Mm-hmm.
And on your second question, the profession itself,
yeah.
Now we have a lot of challenges. Now, as you know, that part of the global economy, we have external architects that will come in and do work here,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes we have to compete directly.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes the client, for probably branding purposes or marketing purposes, they use foreign architects. So which leaves you at a disadvantage,
mm-hmm.
because those firms are bigger,
mm-hmm.
they are well known worldwide, and you are probably become secondary,
mm-hmm.
and you can't compete with them toe to toe,
mm-hmm.
and that affect the profession in the long run.
In the long run, but in that crowded space, if I can call it, would there be any JVs or any mm-hmm. Ways to work together?
Oh yes, we've done work with foreign architects.
Mm-hmm.
There are some good ones that mm-hmm. you can learn from them, like you were saying mm-hmm. Early on. That we can learn from them, or there's a transfer of technology,
mm-hmm.
But not all buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Some buildings, yes. If some of the buildings, as a Malaysian architect, we are developing,
mm-hmm.
we can already do that sort of work.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the major work, yes. But sometimes it has to do with requirements, mm-hmm. where buildings will only be tenanted if it's designed by so-and-so. So that's
a whole different topic altogether.
Yes.
But you know, we look at the country now, at the nation, and we see that there are a lot of new work that has been started or already that's going on. That has shows that there's going to be emergence of new structural concepts, new buildings here and there. We see malls left, right, and center.
Yes, yeah.
How do you think we can term the Malaysian landscape now? What are we like? Are we very historical in our approach? Are we very modern in our approach? Or is it a balance of both?
I think it's a mixed bag. Because again, being a diverse society or a country or a nation, many people have many interpretation, a perception of what a building is or will be. And some people travel, some people don't. And we are sometimes affected by what we see from the outside and try to have it here. But I think it will come a point where as the nation grows and matures and understand that they will know what's right and not what's not going to be right. So the architecture will, I think, like everything else, because we are worldwide, globalizing, you know, and if you're talking about cities, cities are now become generic. You know, what you see in KL might be similar in Korea.
Absolutely.
You see in New York, or which is so it becomes that. And that
almost like a carbon copy sometimes.
Carbon copy. Even if you go to shopping malls, you can have a Louis Vuitton shop here, and if you go to New York, it's the same.
It's the same thing.
It's the same thing. Or you go to airport, and what they sell in KLIA, or you go to a Dubai airport, you still see the same goods have been selling. So I know in future it might change, but now everything is trying. It's almost to level, and people are expecting the same kind of familiarity when they go to a place.
Well, on that note, how do we fare compared to the other ASEAN countries like Thailand and Philippines and some of the other countries that are very much now emerging with their architecture as well?
I think we are fortunate. I've been to some, not to be biased, Malaysian biased or KL biased, but I think we are progressing better. Apart from probably Singapore, because it's a city-state. We have managed, although some might disagree, we have managed better than places like Bangkok, even Manila, even places like Ho Chi Minh cities and all the ASEAN cities, simply because we started with a low population. So we did not grow as fast as some of the nations that are some of the cities even in China. So we although there are a lot of mistakes, but I think there are still opportunity to remedy them. Without having to cause too much concerns to the population. We do that.
A building, when you look at it, whether designed or plain, a lot of times is looked upon as a landmark, or if not, it is a source of some kind of inspiration. As an architect, how do you bring that to the table? Like, how did you ensure that that is produced?
Always in if I've been given the opportunity, when I have that opportunity, it's always an opportunity. You know, when and you are not always, you don't know when's the next opportunity you're gonna get. So when you do that, you try to visualize. Actually, all architects, when they start, they visualize what they wanted. What is your interpretation of that particular building? What you want to do? That is sometimes you lament quite a bit.
Yeah.
There's a process where you lament and you try to weigh your options. And we do in our office several visuals, and maybe that visual we see which is works well. And sometimes we are not the only sole decider, so it has to be put to the test, and all the stakeholders, meaning the clients, the people, will take a look and choose. not necessarily they will choose the one that you like, yes, but they probably choose the one that they like.
That's right.
Yeah, but we try to, as much as possible, to bring somewhere in the middle, mm-hmm, so that you have part of what you want and part what they want. Mm-hmm. But what is more important is that at the end of the day, the test of the completed building will be a welcome addition, mm-hmm, to the city skyline.
That's
if you
right.
do a high rise, even a low rise, it adds space, mm-hmm, a valuable space to the previously probably a void.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
So that in building will create communal spaces, create a urban space that is going to be liked by many.
That's right. Yeah. Well, we're going to take a quick break right now. When we come back, we will continue our discussion about architecture in Malaysia. And my guest in the studio is architect Azim A. Aziz, CEO of ATSA Architects. So stay tuned. We'll be right back. A daily lifestyle morning variety talk show that touches on current topics in Malaysia and around the world. Also featuring compact interviews with guests from various backgrounds. Don't forget to tune in to Channel 502 live from Mondays to Fridays. Hi there, and welcome back to the show. Thanks for joining us right here on The Nation. My guest in the studio with me is architect Azim A. Aziz, CEO of ATSA Architects. And of course, the topic for today is architecture in Malaysia. I wanted to ask you earlier, just before we went for the break, now architects around the world are faced with perhaps a tall order. Sometimes clients can be demanding, sometimes they say, hey, it's up to you. In that case, we've seen many interesting building structures, like in Singapore, you've got the durian-shaped esplanade. In KL, of course, we've got the Twin Towers. Different countries have different iconic creations or concepts. But where does an architect go to find that inspiration? Or rather, the question is, how?
Well, that's actually a good question. And it's actually what we always have to deal with every time we start a project. What you are saying is that in our term is called concept.
Okay.
Where we draw our concept. And most times we are even asked to elaborate on our concept.
Mm-hmm.
We normally look at our concept from many perspectives, not one particular thing. We look at nature, we look at human behavior, we look at, there are architects that look at human structure or body, that are looking at probably distortion of spaces. So for us, we always look at nature as our drawing point, mm-hmm, because we are living in a tropical country, nature, and also what relates to the surrounding. Mm-hmm. How to make it a space that will relate and create that particular building stand out.
Mm-hmm.
Iconic buildings are always a client's dream to have their building featured in the magazine, to have the building talk about. So it is the, for them, it's a money well spent. Mm-hmm. Same amount of money, but it's been featured because it looks good and it looks, it's draw attention. Mm-hmm. So that's the challenge most architects have to face.
Yeah, because I would assume that, you know, you have so many different types of concepts that are out there, and you know, as we become more sort of looking towards the future, we want something more. The word that's coming to mind is more changi right yes, now, you know, something is. More that can outdo each other, and that makes it for quite a challenge.
I always sometimes carry a sketchbook, mm-hmm. and even if I go for a holiday, sometimes I sketch out of nowhere just to, if I find something that's interesting, which I think that it could be converted into a design. So I normally sketch it out and, you know, have
That's a real artist in you coming out there.
Yeah, well, we just sketch out ideas. Yeah. And,
but it's true, because sometimes you get that inspiration and you put that down to
you
paper.
You have to capture that moment.
Yeah.
When you see something, then you sketch it out. And you never know, you might use it down the road.
Down the road, whenever.
Yeah, whenever.
Now, from where we are in 2015 right now, what do you think the future looks like for architecture in Malaysia? What do you think will be like in 2013, 2050, 2030, 2050? Are we going to have sort of very different buildings then? What's your prediction?
I think buildings will remain buildings. We have buildings now that have been lasted for centuries, mm-hmm. and a building that is probably you're talking about ancient buildings that are around for thousands, but the main changes that we can see in the years to come is how fast the building is going to be built. Mm-hmm. As you know, buildings now takes many years to build. Right now, because time is money, mm-hmm. so you can see design being done in building in all sorts of shape, and not a box or just a modular shapes that you just reproduce, mm-hmm. but also shapes and that could be built in a record time. Mm-hmm. It's already happening, mm-hmm. and now technology. With 3D printing, with everything that's coming out that is robotic, and we can work 24 hours, buildings are going to be built in record time.
That's
that
right.
will change how we going to see our whole skyline changes overnight.
Yeah.
Almost overnight.
Well, you mentioned space, and that's a very interesting concept. Of course, as the country builds more and more, space will become less and less, mm. and buildings will want to have space maximized. But sometimes that is not an option. How does that? How from your point of view, how do you try and get maximize the space in a building?
Yeah. You already see here in Malaysia, in KL. You see that a lot of buildings, what I will term it as cradle to cradle. Mm-hmm. You can see now the old Hilton Hotel has been demolished, and for a regeneration of a building, and even the Fudu Jail has been demolished, and the building in front of DBKL, previously is the Tun Razak building, mm-hmm. has been demolished for rejuvenation of new buildings. So buildings, when you look at that, the building has only lasted maybe about 30, 40 years. Mm-hmm. So within 30 or 40 years, you can expect buildings will probably be demolished and rebuilt. Mm-hmm. And the technology for demolishing buildings are not hard anymore. So if space is a concern, old buildings can be demolished, mm-hmm. and new ones can be built. Mm-hmm. That's happening if you go now. Mm-hmm. And that will be something that future architects or future designers or even local authority has to think about, mm-hmm. when you talk about public housing. Mm-hmm. Where public housing, as you can see, percolating flats has been demolished for new developments. Mm-hmm. Percolating flats has been around only about 30 years. Mm-hmm.
So it's constantly changing, yes. and reinventing itself. Yes. Mm. You have to evolve to keep up with the city's
space. At the same time, save what is good to save. some of the historical buildings you don't want to demolish.
But you can help to restore them.
Yeah, restore them, and you won't expect. Yeah, they demolish the train station. You know, or the Sultan Abdul Samad building.
That's right.
You have to restore those buildings for future generation. But some of the modern buildings have no architectural value or so, or you can demolish and rebuild.
That's right. I personally, in my personal opinion, I feel that some of the new buildings lack that kind of artistic inspiration or touch. And I find the older buildings, which are, you know, of course, with lots of space and wide, a lot more beautiful to look at. And you feel different while you're in it. On that note, we do have a lot of old buildings. Many of them have been restored, but some of them not in use anymore.
Right.
Why is that? Because if you go to a city like Rome or Melbourne, they have old buildings which are very much still relevant and still in use.
Because I think there's one term, one thing that restoration is one effort. The other one is to be adaptive reuse, where you adapt and reuse the space. Once you restore the space can be used. And it can be used as a commercial space, or you can use as a museum space, or even a public space.
That's right.
But that connection hasn't been probably done, but it hasn't been planned. So I think the next step for owners or local authorities is to ensure that what can be used, so that it doesn't die or doesn't become just an empty building.
Well, you of course have a keen and a good eye for structural buildings and architecture as a whole. Your personal favourites in KL or all over Malaysia, perhaps three favourites, because I want to go check them out after this as well.
No, actually we have a very a lot of good buildings, and I think the new buildings are coming out everywhere. Not all, like you said, are going to be built nicely. But I think the way I look at it is like that a particular building should be a catalyst for the general area around it to for people to inspire to make the space usable. Some people will say it's probably normal, but I mean obvious. But I think the KLCC is foremost, I think, what has defined KL.
Yes,
that's one.
You can't have the skyline drawing without the Twin Towers now.
Then it's been known everywhere and recognized. I think in terms of the old buildings, I think I've visited just recently the old KTM building, which is actually very nice. That's one probably, I don't know whether it will happen if it's going to turn into a one luxury hotel, but it's still a KTM office.
And that was probably a
nice example to visit. And obviously, and then the third one is that my personal favorite, which I from time to time still go and sometimes for a visit or sometimes to pray, is the National Mosque
as well.
I think National Mosque is one the building modern structure that I think has been timeless. And it has, this year is its 50th year. Yes, and it has, if you go there, it still doesn't seem to age. So that three buildings you say is probably, if I want to go and visit a building, the place, that would be the three buildings that were probably in KL.
Yeah, in KL. We also look at, nowadays people are consuming space quite differently as well. And of course, in buildings, we also talk about another very big issue, which is safety. How do we ensure that people are safe when you are designing a building? I mean, what about the safety aspect in terms of all levels, from its designing to its building construction and then maintenance as well?
In terms of regulation to regulate safety, it's always there. There is a UBBL, in terms of building safety, in terms of a person who use that building, the building is safe to be used or mm-hmm. to be inhabited. But in terms of general safety, for example, safety from theft, safety from bad people, mm-hmm. that is, I think, is a growing concern in KL. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much of a concern, but I think it needs to be addressed. Different cities, if you learn from different countries, they have different deterrents. In London is the most photographed or watched city, and so I was reading somewhere a long time ago, the minute you walk out in London, you're going to be, by the time you get back in the evening, you will be photographed 200 times.
Better be smiling.
So that yeah. that they make sure that you are tracked, and not you have to track everybody, mm-hmm. but it makes people feel in the end feel safer, mm-hmm. and it's a deterrent. Mm-hmm. But here is a growing concern.
Mm-hmm. What about from your point of view, your personal opinion, the kind of buildings that we have, are they built? Made to last from now on? What is the quality like? Because a lot of times we've read building has collapsed, school roofs have fallen, walls are cracking, this and that, which will also be a concern yes. for an architect as well.
Yeah, that's one thing is the workmanship. Mm-hmm. Architects, are the designers, but the builders, many other people are involved, and the engineers, the contractors. And sometimes also when you look at it, the materials that have been produced are not as versatile as it used to be. Mm-hmm. And you can see bad workmanship everywhere. And that is also another area that has to be improved, mm-hmm. so that building can last.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's also a concern and an area perhaps that we are progressing yeah. and moving ahead with. But when we come back after this commercial break, we are going to look at mosque architecture in Malaysia, around the world, and one other iconic mosque that we have right here in Cyberjaya. We'll be back with all that and more. Stay tuned.
Terdapat pembayaran GST bermula 1 Mei 2015 bagi tempoh bercukai bulanan dan 1 Julai 2015 bagi tempoh bercukai setiap 3 bulan sekali. Sekiranya tempoh bercukai anda setiap 3 bulan, tempoh bercukai pertama anda mungkin berbeza. Pastikan tempoh bercukai pertama anda sama seperti di surat kelulusan pendaftaran GST. Pembayaran GST boleh dibuat melalui 3 cara. Pertama, online, portal GST, gst.customs.gov.my, log masuk ke akaun TAP dan ikuti proses seterusnya. Kedua, melalui bank terpilih. Ketiga, melalui pos kepada pusat pemprosesan GST. Poskan cek dan voucher bayaran kepada. Ingat, sila cetak resit pengesahan untuk simpanan dan rujukan. Kegagalan anda menghantar penyata dan membuat pembayaran GST boleh dikenakan. Jalankan tanggungjawab anda sebagai pembayar cukai.
Halo, apa kabar pemirsa? Salam dari Jakarta. Sebuah program kerjasama Kantor Berita Indonesia Antara dengan Kantor Berita Malaysia Bernama kembali hadir menjumpai anda.
Masa mengupas isu semasa, jadi saluran pelbagai suara, segalanya baru dan benar di Berita Bernama TV.
Hi Hi there, thanks for still being with us. I'm Jessy Chahal, and the guest in my studio today is Mr. who's also an architect, Azim A. Aziz, who's CEO of ATSA Architects, one of the award-winning architectural firms right here in Malaysia. Now, we've spoken at length about the architectural landscape, some of the iconic buildings and the issues surrounding that. But one other very hot area currently is green architecture. So perhaps you could explain to us a little bit about what it really is, green architecture, and where are we with that in Malaysia?
Green architecture actually has been a long time. One of the first person who were championing green architecture, although it was called bioclimatic in the world, mm-hmm. was Dato' Dr. Ken Yang. Mm-hmm. He's the first who really mooted the idea of green architecture, mm-hmm. But it was termed as bioclimatic architecture. But since when the oil prices in 2008 were shooting high, sky high, and the carbon increase, emission increase, and caused climate change, people are starting to rethink how to reduce the carbon emission. Mm-hmm. So it started in Malaysia, it started in 2009. Mm-hmm. In most countries, other countries, it started after the year 2000. Mm-hmm. Green architecture is to really look at the building when you design. What are you putting in the building? Is it going to be a gas guzzler, or is it going to be really addressing the climate? Are you going to treat the waste properly?
It's going to save energy.
Are you innovating anything? Mm-hmm. And are you planning it right? So that has forced in a way, like you want to say that it inspired the architect to push the architect to rethink about designing, mm-hmm. and it will become one day you must have it. It's a must have. Almost compulsory that the building has to think about all this, mm-hmm, issue. Mm-hmm. One of the things that even in a green building is water harvesting.
Yeah.
Sometimes the water, right now, most of it is used for grey water, mm-hmm. where you use for your toilets, or sometimes for irrigation. Mm-hmm. When during the day when you want to irrigate your landscape, you use the water
which you collected from the rain, which we have in abundance.
Yes. And it can reduce the because what we use for our irrigation for water are good water.
That's right.
They are water
people even use filtered water.
Filtered water in even washing your cars. Yeah. In some countries you can't even have water.
That's right.
Water is going to be a commodity that will be well sought after in years to come.
Well, so this puts us in a very good place in terms of green architecture for us to grow this and champion this, mm-hmm. Because of the climate, of course, that we have mostly on our side. We see a lot of this in sort of office buildings, maybe larger buildings, and we see this also being applied to new condos, mm-hmm. or even home developments. Do you think it would be equally successful in both types of buildings?
I think it will be, like I said, it will be what is expected. Like, mm-hmm. for example, if you go to a building, when you press a button to go to up the highest most floor, you expect the lift to come. Mm-hmm. Then the lift will come within a few seconds. You don't expect the lift to come 5 minutes from now.
That's right.
So that's the expectation in future, mm-hmm. of when you buy a house, you expect all this have been taken care of. Mm-hmm. No need for you to ask. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that I think is also equally as important is the equipment that you use in your house, your fridge. I still have a fridge that's 10 years old, but you know that fridge is not going to, it's not as efficient if you buy a new fridge now.
That's right.
Yeah, even if you have a car that is 10 years old, the newer car is probably will use less petrol. Mm-hmm. The next step, I think, is to also look at equipment that you have, how much energy they are taking. I recently installed solar panels, mm-hmm. and subscribed to the FIT, mm-hmm. on my roof. Mm-hmm. So the energy that is harvested by the sun, if you sign with the FIT, it will be three times. You sell the amount that you buy. Mm-hmm. Say you buy per unit at $0.20, mm-hmm. when you sell to tenaga, you sell it 3 times the price. Mm-hmm. So you make money.
So you are producing energy,
yes,
which you are then reselling,
yes,
or rather selling back to them and getting paid.
Getting paid. And, and it's for 21 years.
Yeah.
So for the next 21 years, you are able to sell to tenaga.
So these are new concepts that can be applied to existing homes. Mm. And of course, new projects, new office buildings and homes as well will be introducing this slowly. But from green architecture, we move on to, in particular, the mosque in Cyberjaya, yes, which has been a project close to your heart.
Yes.
And it is also known as a green mosque.
Yes.
So tell us about that.
The mosque, as you know, before that, as you know, Cyberjaya was planned in 1997. It was planned to be the future township in Malaysia. At that time, the buzzword was Silicon Valley, mm-hmm, of Malaysia.
That's
so
right.
The perception people had is was that it's going to be futuristic, and everything there is going to be not that you get anywhere else, mm-hmm, but in Cyberjaya. So when the idea was mooted, this is probably the second or third time they wanted to build a mosque, mm-hmm, and the mosque was very much needed then. That we say, why not? Since Cyberjaya is going to be one of the green township in Malaysia and one of the five, I think, around the world that has been observed, mm-hmm, so why not make this as like a pilot project? Mm-hmm. So go for the highest rating, which is the green platinum. Mm-hmm. As you know, Green Building Index, GBI, this is a Malaysian rating system, has several rates, rating from certification to silver, gold, and the highest, mm-hmm, most is platinum. Mm-hmm. So we aim at the highest, mm-hmm, at the platinum mosque. And in that is to go in line with what Cyberjaya original concept is, mm-hmm, is to be the green township.
So in terms of green, then what makes this mosque, what are the features or what makes it unique?
A green architecture, the scientific, one is visually, one is scientific. They have a rating system, a scorecard they call it. Mm-hmm. And your scorecard, you have to be below 90.
To qualify to be a green building.
And the 90 has, you have to have this, that, the other.
Right, so certain criteria.
Certain criteria, your materials that you use have to be recycled, your cooling system has to be a certain level. What are you using for natural ventilation? What sort of concrete are you using? Mm-hmm, you know, and then you look at you know, how you cool the building, the insulation that you use, and the many things. So you to qualify to platinum, you have to go down. They have ranges from 0 to about 250, 300. Mm-hmm. Yeah, average building, even like this particular building we built in the 80s. It probably will rate at, and because they have a BEI, Building Efficiency Index, mm-hmm, will rate that this particular building, will, if it's built in 1980, it will be about 250.
Very high.
High. It's like your car. You use a lot of gas, a lot of petrol. So, what for platinum, you have to be below 90.
Okay.
Zero is you don't use any energy. That means you are carbon zero, carbon neutral. Mm-hmm. That whatever you produce, you will convert it into energy.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, we have a video now that we'd like to share on the Cyberjaya Mosque, which has a green platinum status,
yes,
currently. So let's take a look at this wonderful video.
version, which I don't mind. Not this version, but this version. Which I don't mind. Kalau ada yang buat tu, tak buat.
Headlines, illuminating visuals, everything right and now on BERNAMA News.
I hope you enjoyed viewing the video earlier on Cyberjaya's Green Mosque. Before that, we were talking a little bit about green architecture as well. Now, of course, being iconic, the Cyberjaya Mosque, you were saying that is the second largest in Selangor and can hold up to over 8,000 worshippers at one time.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit more about the experience of building this mosque and how it was to put the final touch on it.
To be frank, it's one of the most difficult buildings that I've been around doing this for 20 years.
Yeah.
It's one of the most difficult buildings that I have to go through and construct because I personally was involved in it. And there are many challenges. Some of it I don't think
we shall talk about on national TV. Yeah.
But in the end, it was completed based on time.
Mm-hmm.
It took 2 years. It was broke. The ground was broken by our PM April 4th, 2013, if mm-hmm. I'm not mistaken. It was completed in February. It was completed early February, but first opened after on the 27th for the first Friday prayers.
Mm-hmm.
And I was pleasantly surprised when it was open. It was packed.
Amazing.
Yeah, it was packed, and I was I thought it was because. When you build it to last at least for 5 or 10 years before it's packed. Eh?
Yeah.
But it seems that it will probably will be packed faster.
Definitely.
Than what we anticipated.
Yeah.
But this is the whole complex. I think we had a great experience, is a whole complex, and we were given an opportunity to design something that has never been done before.
Mm-hmm.
So part of the complex is also a multi-purpose hall,
mm-hmm.
and also the staff quarters.
Mm-hmm.
On the multi-purpose hall, we know that in Cyberjaya they don't have public amenity for a community hall, and we want to do something that is nice to have.
Yeah.
It's to the level like when we first designed like the Felda, the Dewan Felda, or the Sandabi Convention Center.
Mm-hmm.
So, because to have a wedding nowadays, mm-hmm. You got to plan where your wedding is, and you have to plan the dates
way in advance.
Way advance before you can put the date onto your card.
Yeah.
For your children to get married. So what you have, what now is this is giving them an alternative where the hall can fit up to 1,000 people,
mm-hmm.
and is designed from our experience. Going through halls, and it has multi-purpose. You can use for sports.
Mm-hmm.
You have a stage,
mm-hmm.
And then you have for banquet. You have facilities for kitchen preparation.
Mm-hmm.
You can have your own caterers.
Mm-hmm.
So you can, if you have, you can afford $20 a head, $100 a head. You can pick your own caterer. The idea was to pick your own caterer, and then you can have your function.
Yeah. Well, this is of course one of the many projects you can be proud of as CEO of ATSA Architects. We don't have much time on the show, but in a minute or so, perhaps you could share with us some of the other successful projects from ATSA.
I'm very fortunate that in a short period of 20 years, we had done a lot of buildings. One of the buildings that we did is the CIMB Tower,
mm-hmm.
as you can see at Jalan Tengku Rahman.
Mm-hmm.
We did the Islamic University in Kedah, in Al Ostar. We did a Manipal University in
Malacca.
We did a data center, which some of these are nice. And we did a building, a foundation, Al Bukhari Foundation, behind Masjid Negara.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, we are hopefully going to do a few universities. Housing project has always been our forte, and an academy. I like to do a lot of new stuff, and I'm sometimes. It's luck of the draw. You have to be at the right place at the right time,
mm-hmm.
because sometimes you have a lot of ideas and opportunity. You need both of them to match the right people to come to you, and you giving the ideas to them that they will like.
Yeah.
So with the rest of my another half of another 20, 30 years that I may have, I would love to be able to contribute more into buildings that is unique and probably iconic or a showcase building
showcase,
in Malaysia or elsewhere.
Something that that is that has showcases your years of experience, knowledge in the field, and of course a splash of your creativity in there and inspiration.
It's always it's like. Architects are always like artists, you know.
Yeah.
You want builders. You want to create something that is nice. At the same time, I'm also trying to pen down some of my ideas.
Mm-hmm.
As you can see, I did this
with this
just
book.
Completed with this book.
That's right.
We have another book that is going to be. This is for World Mosque.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also doing one for Will after Hari Raya. Hopefully, to publish it is on. the Malaysian mosque, from the oldest existing mosque until the recent built mosque.
Yeah, looking at its architecture and the technology behind it as well.
And the exhibition.
That's right.
We're doing the exhibition. Masjid Negara, as you know, is celebrating its 50th year. Mm-hmm. And we're doing a book and working together with the original architect, Dr. Baharudin. He's 87 years old. And
still strong at it.
and we're building that. We are doing that book together.
Mm-hmm. So there will be an exhibition based on this book, and also to
more mainly on exhibition on the Masjid Negara.
Masjid Negara.
50th,
and that will be on September 5th onwards.
For 6 weeks.
That's right. And to find out more about ATSA Architects, you can of course log on to www.atsa.com.my. Thank you so much for being on the show today and sharing with us.
Thank you for having me.
A pleasure. And we talked, I think, a lot at length about architecture and, of course, the iconic Green Mosque in Cyberjaya. Do check it out if you have time. Thank you so much, sir,
for being on the show.
And I wish all of you a wonderful day ahead. And we'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Bicara isu semasa. Merangkumi segenap ruang. Semuanya dalam ruang bicara secara langsung Isnin hingga Jumaat hanya di Bernama TV. Semasa, mengupas isu semasa, jadi saluran pelbagai suara, segalanya baru dan benar di Berita Bernama TV.